MTWC. We thank God for another Sunday. Even thank God for a cold Sunday in Raleigh, North Carolina. Hallelujah. We are excited about today. I don't even know what to say about the word that God has given me for this morning, but it has been on my heart, in my life, and on my mind, and I am just anticipating what God is going to say and what he's going to do and how he's going to, good God Almighty, how he's going to do what he's going to do this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. It's so good to see smiling faces this morning, and thank God for those that have joined us online as well. So we will get the service started this morning with a song of praise. Hallelujah. We have our minister of music ready to get the choir keyed up this morning. This is not our music. This is not our music. All right. Hallelujah. Turn that up, baby. Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank God for every praise, hallelujah, that goes unto him. Glory God, glory God. So Lord, we just thank you, man. I just, my mind is just everywhere this morning. And I just pray that his presence dwells in this service, because Lord knows he got something in me that is just bubbling over this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So we are going to continue in the service with Lady Monica. Will come and do all that she continues to do. Scripture, prayer, announcements, and of course, what I always anticipate is the Lady Monica-ism. I can't wait to hear that this morning. So without further ado, we're going to have Lady Monica to come in her own and special way. Hallelujah.
All right. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I was so glad when they said to let us go into the house of the Lord. You know, being in the house of the Lord is like, I don't know about anyone else, but it's what you bring in, you know. And sometimes we have to leave out those things that we're struggling with, that we woke up with, that we went to bed with, that we cannot change. So it is good to come into the Lord's house and come with gladness and with great cheer and expectancy. You know, that's what it's about, you know. Whew, God is good. Oh, God, I just thank you. So if everyone would get your Bibles, I'll go ahead and read scripture. It's going to come out of Proverbs, 9th chapter. I'm starting at verse 10. I'm going to read 10, 11, and 12. Okay, so the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. For by me your days will be many, and your years will be added to your life. If you are wise, you are wise for your own benefit. If you mock, you alone will bear the consequences. So I read to you Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10, 11, and 12. And may God bless the hearers and the readers of his read word. If everyone continues standing, and if you're not, if you could stand so we can come to the throne of grace, lifting our voice, clearing our minds, opening our hearts.
Hallelujah.
To talk to our Father.
Thank you.
Lord God, we come to you, God. Coming to you to the throne, God. Some of us, God, are beat up. Some of us are worn down. Some of us are sick. Some of us are just confused in our minds. But God, we know that you are able, God.
Hallelujah.
And for that, we praise you.
We
ask, God, that you would just show us your face, God. And have your way in this service,
yes,
in our lives,
yes,
in our walk with you, God. Lord, there are people, Father, that maybe not know you, God, but people that may not know who you are and what you're able to do, God. But I pray today that something is said either here or someone else, that your word go forward, that they know that they are loved, God, that they have to stay position that they're in,
yeah,
in the loss that they're in,
yeah,
in the drug infested state,
hallelujah,
that they're in,
hallelujah,
in the unsexual, yeah, desires that they're,
hallelujah,
in, that God, that you are able, because you died for our sins,
glory,
and you rose for our justice. For that, God, we praise you.
Hey,
we just,
God,
thank you, God. We just thank you for your amazing love and grace, God. And Father God, I just ask that you continue going throughout this service, lifting this man up, giving him the words you would give him to give to your people, Father. Allow your word to go forward, God. Touch those that are lost. Touch those that are hungry. Touch those that are unloved, Father. Touch those who do not know you, Father, for they are lost eternally, God, if they do not know you. And I pray, God, that something is said that they want to get to know you, God, that they walk to this altar, that they give their life to you, God, and not to the church, God, because it's not about the church, it's about you, God. And I just thank you, God, for who you are, God, and I pray that we continue being obedient to your word, God, and I ask this all in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right. So, guys, we had an awesome Bible study. So, we are talking about the attributes of God, right? Amen. And Pastor Slaughter covered the transcendent God. He talked about the self-existent infinite God. And the God that is uncaused, that is I kind of messed that up, but if you missed it, the word was just so good, and he just had so much meat in that. He talked about the transcendent God. You know, if you guys don't know what that means, go back and listen to that word. He talked about the self-existent and infinite God. It was just so much word in that, so much teaching in that. You know, we come to church and we listen to, you know, the sermons, but Bible study is where we learn. You know, Bible study is where we're taught. So if you missed that, go back. November 14th, go back to that word, either on our YouTube channel or our Facebook channel, and listen to that word. It was so awesome. So we just pray that you continue to be obedient. We will have our couples retreat. We're starting a new series, and that's this Thursday, and it's at 7 o'clock. And it's only for 1 hour, so please bring your spouses, bring yourself. If you're single, looking to be married and be in a relationship, if you're divorced, learning to see what you can do better in the next relationship, or maybe you're someone's coach or you're someone's counselor and you just need to know how you can help someone, even yourself. So this is for everyone, anyone that is looking to be in a relationship. That's what the couples retreat is about. So we just ask that you be obedient to that. And don't forget that we have our Sunday morning worship here every Sunday at 8:30, 3331 Blue Ridge Road, where Pastor John T. Slaughter is our pastor. Okay, I think I've covered all the announcements. Don't forget to follow us on Facebook and Twitter and YouTube and Instagram. And I'm not giving you any of those web addresses because I want you to go to tmtwc.org, where you will find all the information about our church, about giving, about prayer, about the services right there. So asking everyone to go to tmtwc.org. Okay?
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Hallelujah. Now for my Monica-ism.
All right, now.
You guys, change requires you to make a choice. Change requires making choices. It's not enough to dream of changing. It's not enough to desire a change. In order for you to change, you will need to make a decision.
My God.
You must choose to change.
Jesus.
Change is intentional. Are you going to be any different in 6 months? Are you going to be better in a year from now? Are you going to be healthier, stronger, or more mature? Are you going to be happier, less in debt? Are you going to be more like God wants you to be? It requires a choice.
We have to make
an intentional choice in order to grow. There's no growth without change. There's no change without loss. There's no loss without pain.
My God, girl.
The Bible says in Ephesians 4:22, you took off your former ways of your life and the old self that is corrupted by deceitful desires. So remember, choice requires a change. And author, pastor, writer John Maxwell says, when it comes to change, there are 3 seasons of timing. People change when they're hurt enough that they have to, when they learn enough that they want to, and when they receive enough that they're able to. So that's my Monica-ism. That's my Monica-ism. So remember, change is a choice. It's a choice. It's a choice.
Amen.
So now,
amen.
This is where everyone can be a part of it. It's a choice that you give. And we just ask that everyone will get their gifts in hand, that they're given to the Lord. Be a cheerful giver. You know, because when we go to our Father and we pray, we don't pray that he might do it. We don't pray that if he do it. We're praying that he will do it. And he will do it in his timing. And that he knows what's best for us. So when we're giving, we need to make sure that we're giving to our best. We're giving our best. We're Amen. Giving from our heart, not Amen. From requirement or because the pastor's saying that get your gifts in hand. You should already have that in your hand. You should already know what you're going to give God. So we just ask everyone that's on my left, you go left, on my right, go right, and we'll come back together and we'll pray over the offering and Amen. Thank everyone for participating and being obedient to God's word.
Amen.
And those that are online, this is where you have your time. You can go to our website and there you will find three ways to give. We have Giverfy, Tithely, and Cash App. Please make sure that you're being obedient to God's word and that the offering that we receive in this house is for God's kingdom so we can build his kingdom. So if everyone would stand so we can pray over the offering.
Amen. Amen.
Lord God, we just thank you, Father, for your cheerful givers, God. Thank you, God, for those that went into their pockets and was not able to pull out anything, that the next time they go in their pockets, they're over abundance, that they're giving, that they can't give enough, God. We just thank you, Father, for the offering. We lift it up for the upbuilding for your kingdom, God, and we ask this all in your name, Jesus. Amen. So that is my time, and now we will hear a word from my pastor. We'll have a song of preparation, and then what next word you'll hear is from my pastor, John Slaughter.
Amen. Amen. Good word, baby. Give me some love on that.
Good God Almighty. You would have thought we studied together last night. But she was knocked out when I was up writing this message. Good word, baby. My Lord, that blessed my soul. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen, amen. So we are going to get prepared for our song of preparation before we get into the word this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So just govern yourselves accordingly to the announcements. And again, you can go to our YouTube page and that Bible study just really really, really blessed my soul, man. I'm going to tell you, it really blessed my soul. So this is not our music. This is not our music. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I belong to you. Good God Almighty. Can anybody have that testimony this morning? Do you belong to Jesus? Hallelujah, hallelujah. If we could all stand this morning for a word of prayer. Father, we come to you this morning, God. First of all, just acknowledging your presence in this place. God, we thank you for another day, another opportunity to praise and worship your holy name. God, this is the time in the service where we hand you the mic, where we give you your word, where we turn the service over to your Holy Spirit and allow you to orchestrate and demonstrate, speak and teach however you see fit in the name of Jesus. Father, let your glory fall in this place, hallelujah, to where minds are changed, lives are wrecked, and hearts are turned over to you in the name of Jesus. God, we love you. Lord, we honor you and we bless your holy name. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, this morning, beloved, we want to take our time, and I honestly do not know what God is going to do, how he's going to do it. I see what is written here, but I feel his presence bubbling up all in me. So we just going to let God do how God wants to do. This morning, beloved, we want to talk about sin. We want to talk about the title that God has given me is the nature of man. The nature of man, and you know, when I say man, I mean woman as well. The nature of man. Have you ever asked yourself or ever thought, why do I sin? Why do I do the things I do? And we're going to talk about this a little later, but Paul in Romans 7, he brings up a thought process and an experience that every Christian, every born-again believer has in their lives, where we go through this struggle. You know, we want to do good, Paul says, but evil is ever so present. Paul said that I want to do, he said, I find myself not doing. My God. But that I don't want to do, I don't want to be an alcoholic. I don't want to be on drugs. I don't want to lust after that woman. But the Jesus, the things that I don't want to do, Paul says, I find myself doing those things, and I have to believe this morning, hallelujah, that Paul is not alone in these words that he so eloquently shares in this book. I have to believe that every believer finds themselves at a point when there are things in their lives that they would like to be and like to do, but find that evil, hallelujah, is ever so present. Do you believe when you see the alcoholic laying out on the ground, clothes dirty, messed up, do you think he wants to be in that position? Do you believe the person that's strung out on drugs, the crackhead, the weed head, do you think they want to be in that house and with all of the like-minded people around them, knowing that they're destroying their lives, knowing that when they do it, it's always something that you do in private or something that you do when you're around like-minded people because you want to feel comfortable and accepted in what you're doing. So this morning, hallelujah, beloved, we want to get an understanding of why. Why do I do these things that I really don't want to do? I know my flesh sometimes gets weak in certain moments and my flesh yields, but after I do it, I think, why did I do that? Why do I keep yielding to that which Paul says that I don't really want to do? I know my flesh is temporarily, hallelujah, yes, satisfied in what I'm doing, but once I really think about it and I think about how I want to be in my life, where I want to be in my life, the things that I want to do, then I question myself, why, hallelujah, do I do that? I remember growing up as a teenager, I would go out and party and get drunk and be partying. And at the time, my flesh was in it. Todd Father was doing his thing. Hallelujah. But that morning, when Earl was calling in the morning and my body was going through different things and Earl was throwing up and my body was aching and I paid the price for what I did. I remember so many times, I ain't gonna do this no more. This is my last time. I'm tired of feeling this way. I'm tired. And guess what? The next weekend, woo, in the place. Why, Jesus, do we continue to do the things that we don't really want to do? That's not really where we see ourselves. Well, beloved, this morning I'm going to attempt through the power of the Holy Spirit to get an understanding of why Paul breaks down that I want to do, I don't do. But what I find myself doing is that what I don't want to do. Beloved, it goes back to the nature of man. The nature, you know. That's why when I was studying this and God was pouring down in me, it blows my mind. How so many Christians, and my oldest son, we was having a conversation about this, and he was talking about why so many Christians, they want to beat you up with the word. They want to come at you and you ain't doing this and you ain't doing that and you need to do this and you need to do that. And they beat you up with the word. like they don't have no sin. Good God Almighty. I'm in the Word. I'm in the Word. Like they don't have no sin in their life. Why? Lord, I'm going too far in my text. If we could turn to Colossians 3, and we're going to read verses 5 through 10. Hallelujah. Colossians 3, 5 through 10 reads, "Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature." And then the Bible breaks down what is our earthly nature. So Colossians start out, I got to take my time this morning. It says, "Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry." Hallelujah. Verse 6 says, "Because of these, the wrath of God is coming." Hallelujah. You used to walk in these ways, in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips." And verse 9 says, "Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator." Hallelujah. Take off the old. Hallelujah. And put on the new. The text says in that fifth verse, it says, "Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly," hallelujah, "your earthly nature." So beloved, to start off, I think we need to get a definition. We need to get an understanding of what is your nature. When you hear your, what is your nature? What does that mean? Well, beloved, you know, I always like to give the world's definition, and then we'll go into what the Word is talking about when it says nature. And I'm going to tell you, the world's definition was pretty on point. Webster's Dictionary defines nature as an inner force, such as instinct, appetite, desire, or the sum of such forces in an individual. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So beloved, we have to understand that your nature is that what is already innate in you. Is that which you do and you don't even think about. You just do it because it feels good. You do it because you see it with your senses. You can touch it and it feels good. I hear it and that beat. Babe, when I was in the club, I would come in like, "Hey, that's my song." My nature, good God Almighty, was already in sin. We were born, good God, in sin and shape in iniquity. So our nature, our instinct, our appetite, our desire is all ready to walk in, to think and do in sin. Hallelujah. I got a natural desire for the opposite sex. I got a natural desire to hit that weed every once in a while. When I was growing up in high school, for a little while I used to smoke that weed and I had to get myself off of it. But every once in a while, my instinct, my flesh, my nature, hallelujah, stills remember the days when I used to do what I do. It still remember how I used to talk to the ladies and be so smooth with it. It still remembers the things that this flesh, hallelujah, hallelujah, wants to get into. So beloved, we have to understand that it is our nature, our instinct, our appetite, our desires that get us into a lot of the trouble and has us doing a lot of the things that we don't want to do. So beloved, how this significant word is defined determines how one sees the distinction between the old man, which we'll define as our sinful nature, and the new man, which we'll define as our righteous nature. Hallelujah. But see, the difference is when you in the world and you have not accepted Jesus as your personal Savior, the only nature that you will ever know is a sinful nature. You don't even realize that there's a righteous nature. You've heard about it. You hear Big Mom and them talking about it. You hear the preacher preaching on TV, but you say, that ain't got nothing to do with me. I'm doing me. That's what the world tells us today. Do you. Whatever feels good. Whatever you want to do. If it's in your mind and you want to do it, then do it. Beloved, that is the sinful nature. Hallelujah. So one way to view nature is to understand it as a capacity within the believer. Hallelujah. I want that to settle in. The one way to view nature is to understand it as the capacity, hallelujah, within a believer. Thus, the old man is interpreted as the former way of life that an unbeliever has. In this sense, the Christian, hallelujah, y'all hear this, the Christian has two competing capacities within him. He has the old capacity to sin, and then the new capacity to resist sinning. Now the unbeliever has no such competition within itself. The unbeliever only has the capacity to sin. The unbeliever has the capacity to only seek after what his flesh wants. Whatever his flesh wants. However his flesh want to do. Whatever. If I want to hit some weed. If I want to take it up my nose. Whatever my body feels like. That's all I want to do. Because I don't have that other capacity within me. That capacity of righteousness that is within me. Hallelujah. See, beloved, the believer, on the other hand, has the capacity for godliness because the Spirit of God lives within him or her. He's still. Y'all gonna don't throw no shoes at me now. Now the believer still has the capacity for sin as well. See, I know you're sitting here and you got your ties on and your nice Stacy Adams and you got your Louis Vuitton and your hats to the side and you look holy. You look like you got it all together. But the Bible says that we still have God Almighty. We still have that nature that is in us. So beloved, no matter how many amens you give, you still have the capacity within you to sin. Hallelujah. 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 But he now has the ability to resist sin. And more importantly, the desire to resist and to live godly. See, that's the difference between that of a sinful nature and that of a righteous nature. See, when you give your life to Christ, you have the ability. I think my baby said it this morning. We have a choice. Hallelujah. To pursue sin, to pursue unrighteous, to pursue all these things. Hallelujah. We have that choice to do those things. Glory God. And it is only through the grace.
My God.
It is only through the power of the Holy Spirit. See, I used to think that because I'm good God Almighty, because I'm saved and I'm sanctified and I'm filled with the Holy Spirit, that I can stand up and I can stop doing what I want to do, that I can make the decision to do all of this. But I'm realizing that it's only through his grace. It's only through his new mercies. It's only through the spirit of him that is within me that gives me the ability to make a choice, good God Almighty, to follow after the spirit and not fall to the lust of the flesh. So when Christ was crucified, the old man was crucified with him, resulting in the Christian no longer having to be a slave to sin. See, when you're not in Christ, you're a slave to sin. That means sin has you, and it has you believing what it wants you to believe. It has you going places where it wants you to go. And beloved, what's so incredible about it is that because the God of this present world, the God, the little g God of the air is Satan, he places an environment around us that makes it conducive, that makes it easy, that where we can even justify our sin. You can talk to an alcoholic and he will, if you stand there and listen to him long enough, he will justify and convince you why drinking is not bad and that he's all right. You can talk to weed heads. They will philosophize, well, it's legal now. Well, everybody doing it, you just don't know. And they justify, hallelujah, that which is common to them. That's which around them. A sex addict will justify. Sin can be justified in this world because Satan has created an atmosphere that makes it easy to justify sin. He's created an atmosphere where you can feel comfortable because you can always find someone that's doing what you're doing. You know, it amazes me in school, and we talked about this before, where the spirit of a man finds other spirits that are like him. You notice you got the cool dudes that are always together. And you got the nerds together. And the jocks are together. And even in church, you find we gravitate to certain people. And it ain't because of them. It's the spirit that's within them. And it's so easy, beloved, to gravitate to somebody because they're doing what you want to be justified in your life. So you choose to be around certain people so your sin won't be so bad because I'm around people that make me feel good. When I used to go out and party, I didn't, when I was at Ohio State, I didn't want to hang around the ones that studied, because when I did, my grades was wonderful. But my nature saw the cool dudes and saw them talking to the honeys and partying and doing those things. And my nature, because it was that's what I chose to be around, was comfortable in doing that. Until the Bible says, if you bring up a child, hallelujah, the way that he should be, he won't depart far from it. And there came a time where I had to tell my boy that I can't do this no more. And I didn't understand what was going on, but what was happening was that righteous nature that was in me was sick and tired of being sick and tired of doing the same things over and over and getting the same results. Hallelujah. So, beloved, when Christ was crucified, the old man was crucified with him, resulting in the Christian no longer being a slave to sin. Hallelujah. Romans 6:18 says, we have been set free from sin and have become slaves of righteousness. Beloved, it is a choice to choose sin or to choose righteousness. Now, when we speak of the sin nature, we refer to the fact that we have a natural inclination to sin. It's natural for us to sin. It's natural for me to see a woman going by and be like, wow, look at that woman. It's natural for me to see alcohol and want to do it. Why? Because my nature, my sin nature that I was born with. When a child is born, you don't have to teach a child to lie. The child does it because that's his nature. It's in him. That's what he does. That's who he was born in sin. So beloved, we have a nature to sin. So when we speak of the sin nature, we refer to the fact that we have a natural inclination to sin. The choice to do God's will or our own. We will naturally choose to do our own thing. So, beloved, Charles Spurgeon said, listen to this. He said, as the salt flavors every drop in the Atlantic Ocean, so does sin affect every atom of our nature. It is so sadly there, so abundantly there, that if you cannot detect it, You are deceived. And who is the father of deceiving? Satan. The Bible says he is the deceiver of the brethren. Let me read that again. Charles Spurgeon, in his last sentence, he said, it is so sadly there, so abundantly there, that if you cannot detect it, you are being deceived. And beloved, let me tell you, there is a lot of people saved and unsaved. Yes, I did say it. Saved that are deceived and unsaved that are deceived. Unsaved, we know why they deceived, because they justify sin and want to be around their own and go continue to do what they want to do. They don't know no better. But the Christian who was deceived, he justifies his sin by doing the same thing. I remember when I was single in Columbus, Ohio, and I was going to church, and I was saved, but I found myself hanging around some brothers who justified having sex outside of marriage. We talked about how hard it was, and then we blame it on the women. Why these women be wearing stuff like that? Why they do this? And we justified our sin. We justified the things that we wanted to do because we had not built up enough of Christ in us to make a decision opposed to responding to our instincts. See, beloved, what we have to understand is that we get so caught up in this world. And when we get it, when we're in the world, we're constantly repeating actions that we do over and over and over and over and over. And as we repeat it, it repeats it in our minds. And then once it gets in our minds and it's repeated so much that it's downloaded into what the Bible calls the second mind, which is your heart. And once you keep doing it, you keep smoking the weed, you keep drinking, you keep sexing, you keep cussing, you keep doing whatever it is that you do, you repeat it over and over and over, and it gets into your heart. So now you want to be saved because you know and you've realized that the things that you were doing, you don't want to do no more. And now you say, Lord, I believe in Jesus. I believe in your word. I believe that God raised you from the dead, and now I'm saved. And you believe when you're saved that all of that you did is gone. Well, it is gone spiritually because now you have the power to make a choice. But beloved, it's still in your heart. All of that you downloaded, all of that you had is still in your heart.
That's good. That is good. That is good.
So as we are Christians and we're deacons and we're preachers and we're pastors and all kinds of titles that are in the church, we do all these things for Christ, but we still struggle with that sin nature. We still struggle and fight against that which has been downloaded in our heart. So we find ourselves, some of us, being comfortable in sin. Being comfortable preaching on Sunday and going to a bar out of town on Wednesday. We find ourselves being comfortable singing songs that save souls on Sunday. And Monday, being on the internet looking at stuff we know we ain't got no business doing. We find ourselves accepting that which is unacceptable. And we find ourselves growing in the wrong direction, where we have a form, hallelujah, of godliness, but denying the word thereof. So, beloved, the Bible speaks of sinful flesh in Romans 8:3. It's our earthly nature that produces the list of sins in Colossians 3:5, which is that sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed. And Romans 6:6 speaks of the body ruled by sin. The flesh and blood existence we lead on this earth is shaped by our sinful, corrupt nature. Paul admits that the trouble is within me, for I am too human, a slave to sin. Romans 7:14. Paul was in his sinful nature a slave to the law of sin in Romans 7:25. Solomon concurs. Solomon said, indeed, there is no one on earth who is righteous. No one who does what is right and never sins. So, beloved, you can go right now. Stop holding your head up and looking down at folks. Stop looking at the person that don't dress the way you dress and looking down on them. Stop talking down to people like you used to sin, but you don't have no sin in your life. The Bible says that if we claim, 1 John 1:8 says, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in you. So it's time out for walking high-minded. It's time out for talking down to folk like their sin is bigger than yours.
My God.
For we all have sinned and fall short. So, beloved, we don't lose our sin nature once we receive Christ. Can I say it again?
Yes, you can.
We don't lose our sin nature once we receive Christ. The Bible says that sin remains in us and that a struggle with the old nature will continue as long as we are in this world. Paul, in his own personal struggle in Romans 7:15-25, and that's when Paul talks about that, what I do, I don't do, and what I want to do, I don't do. But we have help in the battle. Divine help. The Spirit of God takes up residence in each believer and supplies us with the power we need to overcome the pull of the sin nature that's within us. 1 John 3:9 says, no one born of God makes a practice of sinning, for God's seed abides in him, and he cannot keep on sinning because he has been born of God. Beloved, let me say this. If you are in Christ Jesus and you continue to sin and sin and sin, and it don't bother you, it don't make you feel bad, you don't question it, then you need help. Then there, you must question if the Spirit of God resides in me. Because if the Spirit of God is in me, then when I sin, I have to humble myself and I feel bad and I don't want to do it no more. It's the difference is a lamb. When a lamb is on the out in the field, and let's just say sin is mud. When the lamb gets in the mud, he get this off of me. I don't want this. It looked good, and I know it felt good sometime, but I need to get it off of me. I don't like this no more. That's what the Christian does that has the Spirit of God that's in him. But that rascal who don't got the Spirit of God is that pig. That pig just gets in the mud and waddles and waves in it and gets all in it and loves it. And if you are waddling in sin,
my God.
Then the Spirit of God cannot be within you. I didn't say if you sin. Oh, Jesus. I said if you're waddling in sin, if you're continuing to do it over and over and you have no thought within yourself, you have no consciousness of your sin, then you got a question. If the Spirit, the true Spirit of the living God be in you, then beloved, as I come to a close, what does it mean to be free from sin? Well, to be free from sin means that those who have made Jesus the Lord of their lives are no longer enslaved by sin. We have the power through the Holy Spirit to live victoriously over sin. Romans 8 and 37 says, no, and all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. Just like we once followed fleshly desires, those who are in Christ Jesus now must follow the Holy Spirit. Because we live in a fallen world and are still fleshly creatures, we will still occasionally sin. But those who follow Christ do not make sin a lifestyle choice. And that's the problem with a lot of us. We come to church, we hear the word, but our lifestyle is a choice of sin. 1 John 3:6-10 says, no one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one continues to sin has either seen him or known him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who does what is sinful is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the devil's work. No one who is born of God will continue to sin because God's seed remains in them. They cannot go on sinning because they have been born of God. And that last verse, verse 10, says, this is how we know who are the children of God and who are the children of the devil. Anyone who does what is right is God's child. But anyone who does what the enemy does is a child, hallelujah, of the enemy. Romans 6:1-2 says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? Verse 2 says, by no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live and sin any longer? So, beloved, the only way that we can get through this sin in our lives is in Christ Jesus. 1 Peter 2 and 24 says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we may die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. And as I close, Romans 7, 24 and 25 says, what a wretched man that I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? This is Paul. After he gave the testimony of his struggle in sin, he said, thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself in my mind am a slave to God's law. But in my sinful nature, a slave to the law of sin. Beloved, we have a choice today. If we could all stand. We have a choice to choose to walk in Christ and allow the Holy Spirit to fight our battles, or to continue in the sinful nature and justify our sin by our surroundings. This is not our music. This is not our music. If there be one where you say, Pastor, you're bowling down my alley. I'm tired of doing the same thing. Being around the same people, seeing no hope for my future, and continuing to do the same thing and expecting different results, and I'm going crazy. I'm losing my mind because I'm doing things that I know I shouldn't be doing. And it's time for me to make a change. If that be you, turn it up a little bit, baby. If that be you, would you come? Would you come today and make a stand for Jesus? There may be one where you say, well, Pastor, I'm saved. I gave my life to Christ when I was a child, and then I rededicated my life again in my early 20s. But Pastor, I find myself being caught up in stuff that I know I shouldn't be caught up in. I find myself doing those things that Paul talked about. And you woke me up today because I got comfortable knowing what I was doing was not right. Knowing what I was doing was not what God wants me to do. And Pastor, today I want to rededicate my life. I want to get a clean slate. I want to come up and confess to God my sins. That he may come. That he may do what his word says. That he will suffer and abide with me. That his blood covers my sins. And there may be yet another one where you say, Pastor, I got you. I know I'm a sinner saved by grace. But I like what you and Lady Monica are doing. And I want to be in fellowship with the Master's Touch Worship Center. I want to be around this word. I want to work in the church. I want to help do the things that God has gifted me with. In the Master's Touch Worship Center, would you come? Father, we thank you on today. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your will. And we thank you for your way. God, we ask that you would come even right now. For this word was for everybody under the sound of my voice, starting with me. For there is none of us without sin. But Lord, thank you for reminding us that you are a sin slayer. That you are the only one that can keep us by the blood of Jesus. That we may be seen righteous in your sight in Christ Jesus. Father, I ask in the name of Jesus that everybody under the sound of my voice be renewed in their mind, renewed in their heart, and filled with your power in the Holy Spirit right now in the name of Jesus. Cover our homes in the blood. Cover our finances in the blood. Cover our minds in the blood of Jesus. Lord, walk with us. Talk with us. Help us, God, to make a decision to choose you. Father, we thank you, we honor you, and we love you. For it is in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. And everybody said, amen, 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 amen. I pray that something was said this morning that blessed a soul. If you were blessed by that message, if you were touched and moved by that message, send us an email, send us a message, come talk to me after service. Let's talk about what God is doing. Let's talk about the miracles that God are doing in your life. Let's testify to each other about the power, hallelujah, of God in this place. Babe, was there anything else? Nothing else. Oh, Jesus, I could preach another 2 hours right now. Hallelujah. My baby said, praise God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Join us Thursday for our couples retreat, 7 p.m. This is not our music. This is not our music. Join us Thursday at 7 p.m. This is not our music. Couples retreat, we love to see you, man. We have a good time here, just growing and increasing in love. And yeah, come on up, baby. Come on out and join us, man. We just, the presence of God is here. We're learning, we're growing, and we are on a mission to make families great again. Hallelujah. David, do you have anything you want?
Oh Lord God, we just come lifting our hands, lifting our voices to you, God, just thanking you, God, for your word today. And I pray that someone is blessed, have been blessed by your word that has been brought by our pastor, God. I pray for those, Father, that we go throughout the week, that we be filled with your Holy Spirit, God, and that we get more of you, God, and touch anyone that may be lost. And they may not know you, God. We ask this all in your name, Jesus. We pray. Amen.
Amen. God bless you. I want to hug and shake hands with everybody. If you are online, email us. Send us a message. Let us know what God is doing in your life. God bless you. We love you. And we'll see you Thursday. God bless. I want more of you. I want more of you. I want more of me, God. I want more.
wants all of you. Yes, all of me wants all of you.